Good afternoon, everyone. We have Professor Sachchidanand Mishra this evening to speak to us on a topic which I think is extremely important, particularly in today's world. And I can see that we all have come with a passion to ask or answer that question which he has kind of affirmatively said in the title of his lecture. But perhaps what we have to perhaps look forward is the nature of God in the 21st century and how the God relates with us, or how we relate with the God, and how Indian philosophy looks at God. Well, this lecture is brought to you by a series called Svasthya Rasa Bodhini, which is hosted by NIAS Consciousness Studies Program. The series intends to bring grappling questions in the context of a dispassionate inquiry, at the same time to also understand social responsibility, our own place in the society which we live, and primarily also, I think, to understand the nature of each one of our self, identity, personality, how we could perhaps work on understanding ourselves through creating better well-being for not only for us, for people around and objects around and other beings around. It's indeed a great delight that Professor Sachchidanand Mishra is here. So I welcome him, Professor Sachchidanand Mishra, on behalf of our director, Dr. Shailesh Nayak, and this institute, the National Institute of Advanced Studies. Dr. Shankar Rajaraman, whom you must be knowing, is a well-known scholar and poet. He will be introducing the speaker, chairing the session, and Ms. Niharika Sharma will be giving vote of thanks. In fact, we are also thankful to Niharika Sharma and Dr. Shankar Rajaraman and all colleagues of our program for organizing this series of lectures under the banner Svasthya Rasa Bodhini. So over to Dr. Shankar Rajaraman.
Thank you, Sangeeta ma'am, for welcoming the audience and setting the stage for the program. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Sachchidanand Mishra from Varanasi for the sixth lecture under this series, under the Svasthya Rasa Bodhini series. This lecture is titled God in the 21st Century. Sachchidanand Mishra is a Varanasi-based Sanskrit scholar. He is a professor of philosophy and religion at the Banaras Hindu University. He specializes in one of the darshanas, Navya Nyaya. He was awarded the Maharshi Badrayan Vyas Award for Sanskrit for the year 2009 by Pratibha Patil, the then president of India. And his specializations are in Indian philosophy and Sanskrit grammar. In today's lecture, he shall delve into the idea of God and how it has got modified in the 21st century under the influences of various factors. And I heartily welcome him again and ask him to present the lecture.
Namaha Sabhavya, Sabhapati Bheshchau Namo Namaha. I would like to thank NIAS Foundation, Professor Sangeeta Menonji, and the audience which is present here. I got the opportunity to speak on this topic, this fascinating topic, God in 21st century, and I fear whether I will be able to complete my talk in 45 minutes. Maybe I could take a little more. I would try to conclude my lecture in given time, but it can take a little more. So first of all, in brief, I would like to say, why did I choose this topic? I am a student of Nyaya philosophy, and I started Nyaya because when I was only 15 years old, at that time, while studying one text, Nyaya Siddhanta Muktavali, I came with this Mangalacharana, Nutana Jaladhara Ruchaye Gopabadhuti Dukula Chauraya, Tasmai Krishnaya Namaha, Sansara Mahiruhasya Bijaya. This is Mangalacharana, Mangala Shloka, first shloka given in Karikavali, and the commentary is known as Nyaya Siddhanta Muktavali. And here there is a term, Sansara Mahiruhasya Bijaya. Explaining this term, it was explained that God is actually seed of this sansara vriksha. This sansara, this world is actually a kind of tree, and God is actually the seed of this vriksha, this tree. And here there is a explanation how the idea of seed fits in Nyaya framework. Because according to Nayayikas, God is not upadana karam, material cause of this world, but God is actually only an instrumental cause. So the explanation on this issue and the commentators how taken this point, it was very brilliant. Because the question was asked, why on earth do we believe on God? So the question was raised here, and in my studies, first time I realized that there should be a question regarding the existence of God too. Because being born in an orthodox family and reading Puranas, etc., I never thought that the question, there could be a question regarding the existence of God. And at that time, while studying this text, I realized that there could be a question regarding this issue. And later, after completion of my PG, I did PhD on the topic Nyayabhimateshwarasya Darshanantara Drishtya Paryalochanam. And it roughly translates as critical views of other schools on the God of Nyaya philosophy. Later, it was published with the title Ishwara Paryalochanam. However, I am not going to explain and present the views which are discussed in my thesis. Why? The reason is that at that time I considered only Indian philosophical schools in my thesis. And it was very amazing to see how in India God was not the center of our talk, our philosophical discussions. So here, theistic philosophies, if you see first millennia, in that first millennia there were only a few philosophies which could be called simply theistic philosophies. Other philosophies are not considered to be theistic philosophies. And those philosophies which are taken to be theistic philosophy, like the philosophy propounded by Acharya Shankara, Advaita Vedanta, he also refutes the concept which is propounded by Nayayikas. So this was very interesting to note. And not only this one, but Acharya Ramanuja, Madhvacharya, and other philosophistic schools also rejected the Nyaya point of view. And my task was to explain how Nyaya reacts to those criticisms, and how Nyaya philosophy presents its views. So I will come to that topic later. God is a very beloved topic of the scientists, of the philosophers, of the religious people, theologians, and all love to discuss the idea of God. But there is another point, their approaches are different. Everybody doesn't think, doesn't look into the matter in the same way the scientists study and discuss the concept of God and inquire, but find no proof, this is to say, they find no scientific proof to establish the existence of God. Some of these scientists place themselves in the camp of agnostics, and some of them place themselves in the camp of non-believers, atheists. The religious people never bother to search any proof. They believe in the existence of God. For them, this is a matter of faith, not the matter of experience, not a matter of logic or argumentations. The philosophers are busy making a bridge in between these two opposite worlds. There is another variety of people who are philosophers as well as religious people, and you can say, you can see there are some scientists who are also really highly religious people. Nowadays, only 2 or 3 days ago, when Chandrayaan was thrown in the orbit, there was very discussion and there were many objections regarding the point that the scientist who was engaged in task went to the Tirupati Balaji temple and prayed there. So here I think it will be better to see the development of Western thought first. Thereafter we will turn to Indian point of view. The development of Western thought can be clubbed in 3 phases, however these cannot be separated completely. Earlier it was the study of nature. This phase begins with the Greek philosophy. Then it was the study of man and morals. We see the rise of this phase in the medieval period. And now the thought is directed towards the study of machines. The idea is evolving that man is very much like a machine, and the universe is also like a big machine operating on certain rules and laws. Some frequently asked questions to consider. Does it make any sense to believe in God? If a belief in God serves any good purpose, do we really need God to be moral? Is it reasonable to believe in God in this age? So these are very important questions to consider, to ponder over. And there are some further questions to consider. If God has created this universe, then why there is so much evil in the world? You can see that these questions are formulated, given into account. Let us take for granted that God exists. But if God exists, then why there is so much evil in this world? In what sense we will be free if God exists? And another, some other questions are there. Isn't science enough to answer all the questions with satisfaction? If not today, then in near future. Could religion survive without God, and could human race survive without religion? So these are some questions I will be dealing with here in this lecture. Let us take why these questions arise. Why there are such questions? The point is that now science and technology provided such a strength to the common man which were earlier unimaginable and unconceivable. Science and technology made man free from many limitations, provided luxury which were only in our imaginations, and made our lives much easier. Usually people believe in God due to fear. Just remember there was a film, Three Idiots, and in that movie you can see how the idea of God was presented, how the fear of failing in an examination made people go to the temples. So in the words of Bertrand Russell, religion is based, I think, primarily and mainly upon fear. Believing something due to fear is not right. This is to say, if we are believing in God due to fear, that is not a true right thing. And if we are believing in God, there must be some ground, some logical consistency. And if that is not there, there is a problem with this idea of God. Science and technology have equipped us with so many tools and making us fearless day by day. Earlier, diseases were not curable, and now we have seen that though diseases are very much curable, we can cure even cancer nowadays. So there are genetic diseases also which will be curable, it is assumed, and given the development of genetic engineering, we can see that in near future, and if not in near future, a few years later, there will be such progress that we will be able to get rid of all those issues, those problems. Because you can imagine, we have acquired, we have achieved this development only in 100 years' time. Because 20th century was amazing in this sense. As we have developed in the field of science and technology, only in 100 times, you can see such type of development was not possible even in million years if you take the development of humankind. So let us take the first question. Does it make any sense to believe in God? This question arises to these facts. Earlier, the belief in God was a unifying factor. You can see if many people who are believing, and nowadays also you can see if some people are believing in God, they feel a kind of brotherhood among themselves. So there was a unifying factor, belief in God. But now it has become a reason for hatred. This is not surprising that Richard Dawkins begins a chapter in his famous book, The God Delusion. This is a very famous book by Richard Dawkins. And as it is written, it is a very good book. The great unmentionable evil at the center of our culture is monotheism. Page number 37. What Huntington calls clash of civilizations, that is actually caused by the opposite beliefs in God. Nothing else. Because there are two opposite beliefs, one Islam and another Christianity, and therefore it is called that this is what is happening. It is happening due to clash of civilization. And I think this is actually clash of two opposite religious ideas. And due to that, because they are not open to criticism, therefore all this is happening. So, this question is there, and there are certain answers, and these are answers very problematic. It is said that a belief in God actually makes us divided. We fight with each other on the name of God. We conceive someone our enemy simply because the other person believes in a different good, lives with a different set of beliefs, believes in different scriptures. A belief in God makes us stubborn because we have already decided what is the truth. We are not going to open our position to criticism. We are not going to accept any criticism at all. Makes us full of dogmas. And nowadays, take any religion, you can see there are many kinds of superstitions, many types of dogmas. Actually stops the path of change. And if you see the development of science, how the development of science is seen in last 400 years. You can see Galileo, Copernicus, all these scholars were opposed. They had to fight for their life in their lifetime. So actually stops the path of change, blocks even the progress of knowledge, leaves us with certain set of rules. Because those rules are divine, because it is said that those rules are given by God. So, because those rules are divine, we don't dare to challenge them. We accept them despite they are giving rise to human exploitation, inhuman practices, and cruelty. If a belief in God serves any good purpose, the atheist responds. The answer is clearly a big no. The believers many times commit such horrible crimes, misdeeds, act more violently. There are so many examples. Even Christ was crucified. You can see Christ preached, and the preachings of Christ were against the ideas of Jewish God. And therefore, because you can see that Christ was preaching monotheism, and the idea was also there monotheism, but in Bible you can see there are two parts, but there were something objectionable in the teachings of Christ, therefore he was crucified. So many people have been killed, burned alive, looted in the name of God. So it appears that a belief in God serves no good purpose. Practically, there seems to be no good use of this belief. A person free from a belief in God is actually more open-minded, rational, and free from prejudices. By giving up the belief in God, in fact, we can make this world more beautiful and peaceful. Giving up this delusion, this is called the term I have taken from the book by Richard Dawkins, the God delusion. So we could give up so many other dogmas which are blocking the progress of scientific knowledge as they blocked in the past. So do we really need God to be moral? So this is another question. If morality is dependent upon the existence of God, and if those people who are accepting the existence of God are more moral, the question is actually very tricky. It can be formulated in one opposite way, whether we invented God because we are moral, or we are moral due to God's existence. So I will come to this point a little later. But this is another objection, that belief in God actually doesn't make us moral. There are so many terrorists, according to themselves, they are believers, but nobody can accept that they are moral, because they are committing such crimes which nobody will accept that those crimes are moral, those acts of violence are moral. So this is not possible to accept that in order to be moral, one needs to believe in the existence of God. Even there are many people who are completely atheists, but they are moral persons. So there is a declaration by Friedrich Nietzsche, the death of God, and it is actually long ago. So Nietzsche is notable for having declared in the 19th century that God is dead, for having written several of his works in the presumption that man must find a new mode of being given the death of God. Because it is not in 21st century, but it is only 19th century Nietzsche declared. However, there are people who are saying that this statement of Nietzsche was regarding to the God of Christianity. Charles Darwin, 1809 to 1882, came with the theory of evolution. In the human, in development of ideas of human society, the theory of evolution is very important. Accepting the theory of evolution, it seems to be the case that there is no place left for a creator God, because it is assumed and it is argued by many philosophers, many scholars, even scientists, that we can explain the origin of this universe without taking shelter to God. This evolution can explain the rise of human being, the rise of subjectivity, the rise of consciousness. Everything can be explained taking the help of this biological theory. This is actually a biological theory of evolution. And what are the main statements, basic statements of this philosophy, this concept, I will discuss a little later. So here again, what is so special to 21st century? You can see now more than 200 years have passed since Darwin propounded the theory of evolution. It is actually not more than 200. There is a problem, but almost you can see that more than 150 years have passed. Many notable biologists have revised and polished this theory of evolution in such a way that this theory seems to be explaining the world without any intervention of God. Now we are at the threshold of another evolution. a completely different type of evolution known as artificial intelligence. Because earlier there was evolution of intelligence, and that evolution of intelligence is from actually the evolution of consciousness from matter. This was first evolution, and this is another evolution. We are standing at the threshold of that is artificial intelligence. Now we have supercomputers which are able to defeat even the finest minds of humankind. Just remember, the Deep Blue computer defeated Garry Kasparov, who was then a champion of chess. And now there are artificial intelligence is discovered Alpha Zero. That is very important to know. That Alpha Zero is nothing but only the rules of chess are taught to that program, and that program is working, playing with more accuracy and defeating the champions also in the game of chess. So there are some other notable developments in this area. There is a Turing test, and that Turing test have also passed by some supercomputers, some programs. So it is thought by many that in near future we are going to have thinking machines which will be capable of doing works more efficiently than human beings. So given this, there is an analogy, because we are standing at the threshold of artificial intelligence. So it is very simple to assume that if we now are able to create consciousness in the same way, in the process of natural selection, there was evolution of consciousness. So matter evolved into conscious being. So this is the theory. There is only matter. We need not accept the soul or consciousness. So the world is something different now. So you can see that earlier it was assumed by philosophers that there is a body, and in this body there is a soul. And body and soul, body and mind, these are two there. And here again now there is only one thing, and that is body, nothing else. As you can understand, you can explain the humankind in the way as this is a supercomputer. And you can see a very, very important and very brilliant book written by Richard Dawkins, The Selfish Gene. And in that selfish gene, he talks about how could arise morality, and he talks in detail how in what situations a computer, if the computer is fighting with another computer, how it will decide and how will it act. So there are certain rules, and in that way there will be development. And the computers now, not only they are programmed, but they are also learning. So computer is becoming now learning machine. And human, what are human beings? They are conscious, and also they are learning slowly. And in that way, as in this case, we can see computers are developed in such a way which are learning themselves and progressing day by day. And in the same way, there was evolution of consciousness in matter, and thereafter they are also learning, and in this way there is development. Consciousness arises due to sheer chance through natural selection. So that is the idea. So given this background, there is another question arises. Is it reasonable to believe in God in this age? The belief in God, let us take for the point, the belief in God was never well-founded. Was never well-founded in Indian philosophical tradition and in Western philosophical tradition too. There are, even in India, it was more open to challenges, because there is a religion, and it is very astonishing to see India is only such a country where are religions without God. There is a religion, Buddhist religion, and there is no God at all. In Jain philosophy, Jain religion is also there, and there is no God at all. This statement surely needs some qualifications, because there is an idea that every human being is capable of becoming God in Jain philosophy, in Jain religion. And in Buddhism also, this is the idea that every human being is capable of becoming Buddha, is able to realize the becoming Tathagata. Tathagat means who knows the truth as they are, the essence of reality, who knows the essence of reality. So the belief in God was never well founded. With the rise of modern Western philosophy, the idea of God was always open to criticism. So many philosophers have raised doubt on the existence of God. Among them, there are Hobbes, Hume, Mill, and Russell, to name a few of them. This list is not exhaustive list. I have taken only a few of them here. There are so many. Last 3 to 4 centuries, God and religion has always been in the opposition to the scientific inquiry. And this statement must be kept in its real essence, what it means. Because in West, there was 1,000 years conceived as Dark Age. Dark Age means you were not open to a thought. This was to say, speaking anything against Catholic Church was taken as a crime. And if religion says that sun moves around the earth, you have to accept this as a truth. If it is said in Catholicism, some text, some scriptures, then you have to accept it. So, fighting at every moment, at every place, inch by inch, they are progressing. And in that way, science made its room. And therefore, you can understand why there is opposition between science and religion in West. Arguments to prove the existence of God. Here, again, we have to discuss a few ideas. Are there some arguments to prove the existence of God? And they are classified in different sets. Ontological arguments, cosmological arguments, arguments from design, teleological arguments, arguments for a moral order. I will be discussing this idea slowly. Thomas Aquinas presented some ideas. The unmoved mover, this was the first argument. Nothing moves without a prior mover. This leads us to a regress from which the only escape is God. So the idea was here that there is a movement in this world, and this movement must have been caused by some mover. And who is the mover? In the way, if you are not stopping somewhere, and the idea is to stop somewhere. And what is the stopping point? The stopping point couldn't be someone else, but only God. So this was the idea of God, proving the existence of God in this way. Second is uncaused cause. So all the things which appear in this world, they are caused by something. So, but like you take if some example, the table is caused by wood, and wood is caused by something else. So what is caused by someone? And in there is a chain, and where the chain stops? Here again there is another question, where to stop the chain? So in that way, there is nothing is caused by itself. Every effect has a prior cause, and again we are pushed back into regress, and there is only one shelter, to accept the existence of God. The cosmological argument, there must have been a time when no physical things existed. Physical things exist now, therefore there must have been something non-physical to bring them into existence, and that's something we call God. The argument from degree, we notice that things in the world differ. There are degrees of, say, goodness or perfection. So where is no degree, that is called God, the perfect being. That perfect being is God. The teleological argument, or argument from design, because as these things are evolved, as seen today, if the mountain are there, if the rivers are there. So these are somehow designed, otherwise there was no possibility of these rivers and etc. And this is another point. If you take any being, any creature, you will be astonished to see that everything is full of the full of design, something special to them, everything. So argument from design. So what is ontological argument? This is very interesting one. In brief, I will be discussing it. Anselm presented such an argument. In brief, this argument is as follows. And this is very important to note, that this type of argument is now nowhere presented in Indian philosophical tradition. And this ontological argument is something to talk about, that you conclude on the, you deduce something on the basis of having an idea. Because there is an idea, therefore you have to conclude that there must be some reality. And in brief, it is formulated in this way: God is a perfect being. A being that doesn't exist in the real world is less than perfect. So I have the idea of perfect being, and that perfect being could not be perfect unless he exists. Therefore, there must be, it is proved that existence of God is there. Therefore, God must exist. And this idea, this argument was refuted posting another argument in the same way. Suppose I have an idea of a perfect person or perfect island. So there is no perfect island in this world, but I have the idea of perfect island. So in that way, if perfect island doesn't exist, that could not be a perfect island. Therefore, on this ground, if I conclude that there is a perfect island, this conclusion would be completely wrong. So this argument is false. It is a false type of argument. And it is also very important to see that this argument was presented in the Dark Age. What I call Dark Age in Western philosophical tradition, in that way it was presented. There is another, and this is very interesting one, Pascal's wager, it is known as. Blaise Pascal argued that one should better believe in God, because if one is right, one stands to gain eternal bliss, and if one is wrong, it won't make any difference. On the other hand, if one doesn't believe in God and turns out to be wrong, one gets eternal damnation. Whereas, if you are right, it makes no difference. Therefore, one should believe in God. A very similar statement of Udayan is also available, where Udayan says in the same way that nastikastu hato hataha. If you don't believe and it turns out that there is a God, so you are in a wrong place. So you should believe. But this is again a difficult type of argument. Some other arguments are also there, the argument from scriptures. And many people believe due to scriptures are saying. And what I presented in the beginning, Nutana Jaladharuche Gop Badhuti Dukul Chavraya Mangalacharan, in that it was first said, however, Nyaya accept that there are four Pramanas, Pratyaksha, Anuman, Upaman, and Shabda, but it says that you cannot believe in the existence of God because scriptures are saying. Because there is a possibility that scriptures are cheating you. Because if this is the nature of God who cannot be experienced, how could you believe on scriptures? So there must be some other way around to prove the existence of God. And the Nyaya way of proving existence of God is something different, and it doesn't fall in all these categories simply. However, you can say that this is a cosmological type of argument. I will be explaining, and I am leaving all these arguments. Without explaining these arguments, I am leaving because time is not there. Here, the problem is that could any of these arguments satisfy the atheist? The atheists are not satisfied with any of these arguments. There is always an opposite explanation available. Because whatever argument you are putting, he is saying that this is not possible to accept on this ground. What you call Pascal's razor, that is also not a very good thing to accept, because here there is a dialogue presented somewhere that Bertrand Russell was asked the same way, that you don't believe in the existence of God. Suppose you die and you find him in front of you, God, and God asks you, why didn't you believe in me? So Bertrand Russell replied, no sufficient evidence, God, no sufficient evidence. So because there is no sufficient evidence, so I didn't do any crime. So I should not be punished on this ground, because there is no sufficient evidence available. So it is better, because I am more honest. Because I am taking the evidences. And if there is no evidence, how should I believe in the existence of God? So the argument was put here, the argument from design. This picture is taken from a book, How We Believe. How We Believe, and page number 102. And the book is written by Michael Shermer. And the whole title of this book is How We Believe Science, Skepticism, and Search for God. And in this book, he has taken, just see this picture, there is no design. But it appears to be there is a design. You can see that it appears that in between these four designs, there is something, there is a... so this is not there, but it appears to be the case. So this is the same story with this world also. There is no design in this world, but it appears to be the case that there is a design in this world. So where are we standing now? So taking all this discussion, taking all these arguments, we are present at this position, which is known as the Charvaka way of thinking in Indian philosophical tradition. According to Charvaka, and this philosophy is very much neglected philosophy in Indian philosophical tradition. And this is very many times I observe that the part which was neglected here is evolved so beautifully in Western philosophical tradition. So Charvaka has propounded the same theory without giving so much explanation. According to Charvaka, consciousness arises from matter. And kirnvadibhyo madhashaktivat, as there is a toxication produced in the wine, there is no toxication present in grapes, but there is toxication in wine. So in the same way, there is no need to believe in any supernatural being. There is no God, no soul different from body. So this is the Charvaka way of thinking. And simply if we say, we have two pictures to consider. There is a creator God. There is a design in world. This grand design cannot originate without a creator. This is very important to note. There is a book written by Stephen Hawking, The Grand Design. However, he is saying it a grand design, and when you are taking the term design, it means there is someone who designs it. But Stephen Hawking doesn't believe that there is a designer present who designs this world. And so this grand design cannot originate without a creator, and there is a moral order so in this world. Second picture is there, no creator, there is no design in this world, only an appearance of design. There are only blind natural forces. How everything is originating? Kenidam chitritam tasmat svabhavat tadvyavasthiti. Everything originates only naturally, by nature. There is nothing else which is responsible for. Everything is explicable as a natural process, even the moral order. If God created this universe, then why there is so much evil in it? There is clearly injustice into the world. The right are seen suffering and wrong are seen fully enjoying the small children with genetic diseases. If God is omnipotent and if God is omnipotent and good, why there is so much suffering? This is the problem of evil, very much discussed in Western philosophical tradition. And the point is that actually when you conceive this idea that God is there who created this universe and who created this universe out of nothing without taking help of anything else, because there is nothing else, then there is a problem. How will you explain the evil? Because you accepted that God is omnipotent as well God is good. So these two things cannot go hand in hand. They are very much incompatible with each other. So there is a problem. How could we be free if God exists? There is another incompatibility between these two concepts, the freedom of human being and omnipotence and benevolence of God. If human beings are free, how could they be free? God created us and knows beforehand what we are going to do, but He doesn't prevent us from doing that. He is not preventing us when we are acting in such a way. We are acting, committing a crime, we are looting, we are raping. In that case, there is a problem with this concept. He is all powerful, but doesn't make us free from suffering. This is also a very ridiculous thing. Here again there is a question, isn't science enough to answer all the questions? The point is raised that if science cannot answer the questions, then those questions are actually pseudo questions, they cannot be answered, but the existence of God is not such type of a question. It can be answered. There are thinkers now who are presenting that there are two types of agnosticism. One is temporary agnosticism in practice, and another one is permanent agnosticism in principle. Temporary agnosticism in practice, that we don't conclude in the favor of any position. We leave it for some time. Let us take some time. If there is any evidence coming, and if any evidence is coming, then we will accept. And if the evidence is not coming, we will not accept. So there are many thinkers who propose that actually the question regarding the existence of God is coming in another group, permanent agnosticism in principle. Because you cannot decide the existence of God on the basis of any arguments, any evidences. But in the book, The God Delusion, Richard Dawkins presents that PAP style of agnosticism is appropriate for questions that can never be answered, no matter how much evidence we gather, because the very idea of evidence is not applicable. So actually, this is very peculiar type, interesting example. Suppose what I am seeing as blue and what you are seeing blue, this question, if raised, cannot be settled, because there is no guarantee that what I am calling blue, when I am using the term, in the same way you are perceiving the blue, it is not a guarantee. There could be some difference. So if there is this point, then this cannot be settled. But the question regarding the existence of God doesn't come in that way. According to modern atheists, the question regarding the existence of God falls not in second type of agnosticism, but first type of agnosticism. Now we have ample evidences to show that God doesn't exist. This is their statement. Agnosticism about the existence of God belongs formally in the temporary or TAP category. Either He exists or He doesn't. It is a scientific question. One day we may know the answer, and meanwhile we can say something pretty strong about the probability. So in the same book, Richard Dawkins said. So here when he is saying, and he gives some explanations also, how he is taking this in this category, TAP category. And the point is that what is the idea of God he is taking, that is the problematic thing here. The idea of God he is taking, that who creates everything and everything out of nothing, and creation is first creation. These are 2 points. And if these 2 points are together, then there is a problem. Dawkins begins by stating the God hypothesis. There exists a superhuman, supernatural intelligence who deliberately designed and created the universe and everything in it, including us. The bold is mine here. So here, this point, what I made bold, it is nowhere accepted in Indian philosophical tradition. And this point, which is nowhere accepted in Indian philosophical tradition, if I take it away, then only we can say, and in the same way, it is not included here, however there could be some questions, but if you take Kashmir Shaivism, it is also a kind of non-dualism, but here again, this type of existence is not accepted, that God has created this universe first time, because we believe in creation and dissolution. Creation is also there and dissolution is also there. And now how the science is coming to this conclusion, the scientists are coming to multiverse theory. There are multiple universes. And this multiple universes and this universe in which, and if you take the theory of relativity, according to that, every being who is present in this time frame, because when you are pinpointing something, you have to pinpoint taking this fourth dimension. The time is taken as fourth dimension. And if you take this fourth dimension, there are different dimensions of time in the same this universe. And if you talk about multiple universes, there will be somewhere different creations and creation and dissolution again and again. So the idea of God is, this idea of God is foreign to the philosophers of India. Nyaya, one of the most theistic classical Indian philosophy, which doesn't accept that the God creates us. According to even Kashmir Shaivism, God is not the creator in this sense. I am not going to discuss it here because time will not allow, but distinctions are available. So in brief, I will be discussing, and time is almost going to end. So the Nyaya idea of God and soul. According to Nyaya, God is omnipresent, omniscient, omnipotent, eternal. But here there is a very big problem. When you talk about omnipresent, it must be defined very, very precisely. Omnipresence is defined in the way that God is conjoined with everything which is in motion. And in the same way, every being, every jiva, every soul is also omnipresent. It is not that we are limited to this body only. This, you can say, in the world of, if you take the words of Swami Vivekananda say that the Atman is such that it is a kind of long, big circle whose center is this body. Where? But this is not only this center is there, because, and this, what is happening, this center is getting changed when one is dying and getting again reborn. So omnipresent is applicable to God and jivas, both of them. Omniscient, God is omniscient, but jivas are not omniscient. They know only a little. This is the, you can see that between God and jiva, there is a quantitative difference in this sense, because God knows everything and jivas know only a few things. Thirdly, God is omnipotent, Because when you, what does it mean omnipotent? It doesn't mean, there is a long discussion in Western philosophical tradition regarding omnipotence of, and there are many questions are asked, whether God can make the true false, whether God could make a rectangular triangle. So there are different type of circular triangle. So there are certain questions are asked, and those are actually imaginary questions, because according to Nyaya philosophy, God is not even if you use those parameters, the Nyaya God would not be considered as omnipotent at all, because he is not able to create this world out of nothing. He must have some samavayi karan, some material cause to produce this world. So here again the idea is different, and here he is not omnipotent in that sense, but he is omnipotent only in this sense that whatever he knows, he is causing that everything. Like the very beautiful example is given that nothing can be produced if there is no rain. But if rain is there, then there could not be rice if you didn't sow the rice. So only if what you are sowing accordingly, that is produced, and God is considered only as a sadharan cause, sadharan karan, general cause. So he is responsible, but he is not solely responsible. So if there is evil in this world, this is not the responsibility of God. This is the responsibility of ourselves, these jivas, because they are there from beginningless time in the same way. So here again, as God is eternal, the soul is also eternal. And how the Nayayikas are coming to this conclusion, and these are some basic ideas which are very much accepted in many philosophical traditions of India. If you take Vedantic idea of God, here again you can see God is mithya and jiva is also mithya. God is beginningless, jiva is also beginningless. So there is a great similarity, and that what I highlighted earlier, that is here in Vedantic idea of God also. God is omniscient and the jiva is not omniscient. God knows everything, but the human being, the jivas, don't know everything. Actually, the objections which are taken here, Udayana grouped these objections in five categories. And first one was, these all are not to be dealt with here, because there are some opponents regarding them, these objections are raised. Alaukikasya paraloka sadhanasya abhavat, because there are no instruments to achieve something otherworldly. This objection was raised, objection was raised by the side of those people, atheists, charvakas. And another point, which was anyathapi paraloka sadhana anushthana sambhavat, this objection was raised by mimansakas. Mimansa tradition is also a very important tradition, but they don't believe that God created this universe. This is very important observation to note, that Mimamsa, this was a very prevalent philosophy and of India, and in that philosophy God was not at the center of this universe. Again, another question is tadbhava vedak pramana sadbhavat. There are arguments, there are proofs to prove that there is no God. And here all these arguments, these questions are answered one by one. Sattvaipi tasya apramanatvat. Even if God exists, he is not a praman, he is not authentic, we shouldn't believe him. Tat sadaka pramana abhavat. There are no proofs to establish the existence of God. So there are four arguments in favor of God presented by Nayayikas, the cosmological argument, but not in the same sense, because the point is that the argument is put forward by these atheists that God cannot be proved by unaided reason. Unaided reason means the reason which is not aided by scriptures. So without unaided, you cannot establish the existence of God through unaided reason. So here, these cosmological arguments are there to prove the existence of God, and in this way, there is a difference here. As it is formulated, every effect need to be caused by an agent. And we observe many examples. And here again, there are questions, and these questions are raised by Buddhist and Jain philosophers, as well as some Charvakas and other philosophers, that there are many things which are not known to have caused. Uncaused effects are there. But the Nayayikas say that, hey, there is a problem with your argumentation. And the problem is this, that all those effects which you are showing us as not having a cause, there is a doubt whether they are having a cause or not. But these effects which I am showing you, like a pot, like a house, like a mobile phone, etc., these are having someone who caused them, who made them. So the world is an effect, and the Nayayikas also proved that the world is an effect because it is produced. So therefore it must have been caused. The argument from moral order: one will not get rewarded or punished according to their deeds if there is no God at all. So here, again, if you are very much satisfied in this world, this is your choice. Because you are not going to take any question as long as to settle beyond this scope of your physical world, then you must accept that there is no justice at all. There is no freedom at all. Because everything is there here in this world. You are not free to act in that way. Your freedom is limited. So in this case, if you are asking about justice, there is no justice at all. So here, the arguments from moral order, one will not get reward. And again, there are some more points to note. The arguments from an author of Vedas, and this argument is also very interesting one, because there are Mimamsakas who claim that there is no author of Vedas. Vedas are there from beginningless time in the same way. So this argument is... it is against the Mimamsa philosophy, Mimamsakas. So what is the problem with creation? Only taking one or two slides, I will end because there must be time for discussion. So there is a book by Carl Sagan. This is a renowned physicist, Cosmos. He asked my very simple question to religionists: who created God? In many cultures, it is customary to answer that God created the universe out of nothing, but this is a mere temporizing. If we wish courageously to pursue the question, we must, of course, ask next where God comes from. And if we decide this to be unanswerable, why not save a step and decide that the origin of the universe is an unanswerable question. Or if we say that God has always existed, why not save a step and conclude that the universe has always existed? So take the statement, the arguments by a physicist, and this is the same position adopted by Nyaya and also Advaita Vedanti philosophy. Here, when we think of creation, it is conceived as creation out of nothing and creation in time. But for Nyaya, creation is not out of nothing. God creates this universe but doesn't create the world out of nothing. Here there are some postulates of morality, Kant's postulates of morality, the existence of God, human freedom, human immortality. These three are accepted in Nyaya philosophy, and I am skipping this point because there is no time at all. So the point I would like to raise here, in Nyaya, Atman and Ishwar, both are eternal, and God has not created the Atman. In the same way, where it is declared that this world is mithya, there also it is very important to note, according to Advaita Vedanta, Jiva Isho Vishuddha Chit Tatha Jiveshwayor Bhida Avidya Tachitor Yoga Shadasma Kamanadya. These six are eternal, beginningless. The term is there, beginningless. there is no beginning at all. So here, as Carl Sagan objected, in the same way it is accepted here, that those objections, if you say that this world is there from beginningless time. So this is the question. Here you can see the difference. In Western philosophical tradition, when you talk about God, the God comes to save this, to answer this problem, what is the beginning of this universe? And here, there God doesn't come to save us from this problem, because we don't believe that this is beginningless. This has a beginning, because actually the world is beginningless. Jeev is beginningless, Ishwar, God is beginningless, the pure consciousness is beginningless, and the difference between God and soul is beginningless, and the ignorance is there from beginningless time, and its joining with consciousness is also beginningless. So here we don't accept, we don't postulate the existence of God to answer this problem which we are facing in this world. And here again there is a point to note that here the philosophers of India are of this opinion that this cannot be decided when this world originates. In Mimamsa, it is said that the world is there from beginningless time in the same way, but other philosophies accept that this world is same here, but there is dissolution and creation. The world is created and dissolved. So circularity is there. Every creation follows a dissolution, and every dissolution follows a creation. So there is a difference. Sorry, again. So here the point is that one actually, how this philosophy origin comes to the conclusion, it is actually a kind of metaphysical naturalism. And here, at this metaphysical naturalism, Advaita Vedanta philosopher Acharya Shankara repeated this in Ikshatyadhikaran. So here, point is there, this is a matter of choice, not argumentation. If ye non-believer says that your position is incorrect, this is very well could be said that your starting point is also incorrect, because it is a matter of choice how you see it. If you are satisfied with this explanation that everything is coming in random order, it is coming without any intervention of anyone else, then you can be satisfied at that. But if you are not satisfied with it, then there is an existence of God which could be proved by unaided reason without intervention of any text, any scriptures, that there is a creator of this world. But the creator should not be there in such a sense. There is no mystification is required. The Nyaya is always against any type of mystification. So here, and one point, there is also a pragmatic view you could take it, utility of God. The objection is ill-founded that the belief in God serves no purpose. Actually, as we progress, the uncertainty of life is always there. We find the courage and hope due to belief in God. Even Richard Dawkins finds that the idea of God has a great psychological appeal, therefore has a great survival value. See The Selfish Gene, page number 193. So, shall we gain anything from this debate between these scientists and theologians? The point is that you cannot disprove the God in true sense, anyhow. And actually the problem is not with the God, but the religion which operates on the name of God. And therefore, these scientists are against the concept of God, these atheists. And because these superstitions cannot stand their own without taking the support of God, therefore there is a problem. So, separate separate superstitions from religion, I would like to end my lecture with a statement by Swami Vivekananda. He gives this statement, a study of religion. Is religion to justify itself by the discoveries of reason through which every other science justifies itself? Are the same methods of investigation which we apply to sciences and knowledge outside to be applied to the science of religion? In my opinion, this must be so. I am also of opinion that the sooner it is done, the better. If the religion is destroyed by such investigations, it was then all the time useless, unworthy superstition, and sooner it goes, the better. That means we should accept somehow, but we should be always be very careful what is coming in front of us in the name of God. So that was there. I have taken, I think, much time, and I don't know whether I could do justice to the topic or not. Some questions which were there also, I could not discuss. Thank you very much for listening to me in such a way. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sachchidanand Mishra, for such a comprehensive view of arguments for and against the concept of God, and also its implication for 21st century, the implication of the God concept for 21st century. Now, the floor is open for questions, and I'm sure because this is a topic of great fascination for everybody, there will be several questions. So,
thanks for the presentation. Like, I am just an observer on this whole discussion. From this particular discipline, but I tend to discuss and think about, we used to discuss more about what is God and why it is existence. So do you have any idea about accepting the randomness in life can be a substitute for thinking, okay, there no need not to be a God there. You think whatsoever happening in this world because it happens anyway. So do you ever thought the randomness is one of the possibility which is leading to the question of God? And this is the first question. Second question is, the political science deals God in a very different fashion. But do you find the science also finds the God in the same fashion? Because political science is always an antithesis to the God. So what is your view on that?
Political science?
Yeah. Like, for example, Hobbes, you mentioned Kant and Rousseau. So these people are always, they never go into the inquiry of God, but rather they always negate, even in the first sentence, there won't be, or there is no existence of God from the beginning itself. So, what is your idea on that?
Thank you very much. Randomness is in life. Actually, this randomness could be seen from two perspectives. We accept the randomness without any intervention of anyone else. So that will be called yadrichhavadin charvaka terminology. What is appearing, it is happening by chance. So if you believe in that way, you can believe. So actually, what I am willing to say, these are actually darshanas, philosophies. And here again also, I would like to make a little bit of difference between darshan and philosophy, because darshan is a complete picture and philosophy is not a complete picture. Many times it deals with only partially. So darshan is a complete picture of reality, one complete picture of reality. Suppose you are taking a picture from a different perspective and another person is taking the picture from different perspective. One picture is looking beautiful and another is not looking so beautiful. So here again, what is there to accept, which is true, this one or that one? So here again we are left with this option when the question randomness in life. So many people are not satisfied with accepting this randomness in life, and they take it that it is coming from someone else, some other sources. And here when you take this randomness in life is coming from other sources, in Indian philosophical tradition, it is never said that this randomness in life is coming from God. But it is coming from your own karmas of past life. This is the point. Therefore, Buddha dared to negate the existence of God, but didn't dare to negate the existence of fruition of our karmas. So that is the point. Second, political science. Actually, political science scientists are people who are inclined to accept that all the questions should be settled here only. The question should not be taken in another world. So if this is my statement, this is my position, why should I believe in the God, in the existence of God? Existence of God is no way useful for settling any question in this life. So that is the point of political scientist.
Thank you for a very comprehensive lecture. You have touched on very many points within the limited time. I was wondering, in India particularly, perhaps, we hear a lot of, I think there is generally a great amount of belief in destiny.
Yeah.
So in, I think it cuts across all classes and all religions, and the belief is very strong. So how would you, do you really connect destiny and God, or do you think they are not connected at all?
Okay, if you take the Nyaya position, they are going to connect this destiny with God. And this destiny is connected with God, it doesn't mean that God is responsible for your karmas, your action, your happiness, etc. Whatever you are, because when in Gita, Shri Krishna says that whatever you are performing, you are doing, you must bear the fruits of those doings. So the point is here that whatever you one is performing, one is bound to nakritam kshiyate karma karam janma koti shatai rapi. So that is there. But the point is, when you are going to enjoy the fruition of those doings, it is there, it is in your hand. How you are performing? Suppose you are performing good actions. In that case, you are getting, you have to get the fruition of your good karma in this life. This is again, this is a possibility. So there is a connection, and the Nyaya tries to make a connection between destiny and God. And destiny, the term I am not willing to use actually, because when we take the term destiny, it is something which is predetermined completely. So in destiny, when you are talking about this destiny, this is not the case. The Nayayikas are fond of using the term adrishta. What is not seen? Adrishta means what is not seen. It is not seen means it is not in our control. Because what is seen, we can control. And what is not seen, how should we control that? So that is adrishta in Nyaya philosophical tradition, position. So they take that this is, there are some adrishta reasons, therefore it is coming. So that is the point. But it is more or less very much related to destiny.
Artificial intelligence seems to be overtaking this world, right? And the stress seems to be from every institution to want us to go that way. Okay. Now, if you're going to go into this artificial world, and you know, not, are we going to allow that absurd phenomenon to overtake the existence of God? Is that, do you foresee a fear of that happening at all, and how can we prevent it? Or
actually, the point is that when we discuss the concept of artificial intelligence, the point is seen in this way, that there is matter, and from matter consciousness is arising. No, artificial intelligence, there is hardware, and from hardware there are some actions performed. So that action, that is called artificial intelligence. That artificial intelligence is one thing, but it is a way of acting which is called artificial intelligence. This is available now. Suppose I am getting an Gmail, it says how to reply. There is a, when you try to reply, it comes thanks or something else. So this is actually artificial intelligence, and this is the beginning of artificial intelligence. So there could be some time, spend some time, and you can see that artificial intelligence is working in many fields. So here the point is that The hardware is that, suppose you are taking a computer. What is this computer? Computer is there and there is software. This is simply a matter. This is simply a matter. And this matter is aware of. If there is a robot. Robot is there. And if you are going to cut the robot acts. Robot sees. And robot is aware of your presence. So here what is happening? Robot is aware of your presence. You are aware of that robot. So here you are conscious of that robot. And robot is also conscious of your presence. So this is artificial intelligence is working. So if you are taking this mechanical universe, and the point is that science is taking and it is evolved from materialistic philosophy and materialism says that everything is there, only matter is there and nothing else is there. So God, when you are talking about God, God is something different from matter. So the point is there are different ways to say that this artificial intelligence, whether it is a challenge to God or not. This is the point. And if you say, if you ask this question from Indian philosopher to answer, I say there is no challenge at all. Because when you are asking this, you are not understanding actually the nature of consciousness. What we are calling Atman is not consciousness in that case. Because in Nyaya, the cognition of something is taken to be consciousness. And this is accidental. This is accidental. If conditions are fulfilled, then there's this consciousness. So you are able to make a calculation. You are able to move the computer, act in a different way. But it doesn't prove that you are able to create the consciousness, create the Atman, or something which is very much similar to Atman. So there is no challenge at all. The point is this. Yeah.
But then I could not get very clearly as to what was the answer to it.
Is it
purely our free will, if we have free will? Does that result in this evil in the world or otherwise? What is the source of this evil?
So the point is that if we take this Nyaya framework, in this Nyaya framework, and also if you are taking Advaita Vedantin framework, there is also the same type of answer. Because if you are taking evil, why this evil is coming? What is evil? It's actually the product of our action, sometimes my action, sometimes the action of others. You may raise some questions. Suppose a child is dead. What is the fault he has performed? Because he was only 5 years old. And here, actually, this world is very much connected. And if I am suffering, in that case, some other people are suffering. Suppose a child is dead, only one is not suffering. There are many people who are suffering. So the collective responsibility is there. And you can see that Nyaya can save the problem of evil from this perspective, that there are collective works and which are responsible. There are something many people enjoy together, and there are some calamities, some problems, many people are unhappy with, many people are suffering. So this evil is actually produced by ourselves. And Nyaya position is there that we all are producing this evil. And God is not responsible for that, because God has not created us. We are there from beginningless time.
Could you tell me the differences in the six darshanas? I have not been able to go very deep into any of those. But what are the main things like which you would say that which differentiates them?
I will not be able to make the differences clear in this discussion, because it will take time.
Okay. I'm going to ask you another question then. In Buddhism, they say there's a continuum of thoughts, right? So then you're born again and again and again. So what's your take on that?
Continuity of thoughts.
The continuum of thoughts, where is that's how you're reborn, because
So in that way, they try to explain the problem of evil, problem of action, what you perform, who is enjoying the fruits of those doings. So in that way, they are explaining this. And again, this is a problematic point in Buddhist philosophical tradition, and it will take much time.
So I have this question about God of 21st century. So you mentioned that people like Richard Dawkins talked about religion creates a lot of unfreedoms, which stops you from pursuing your scientific temper and stuff. So what I feel is there are like religion can be looked upon as a way of ordering your society. It can also be looked upon as a way of experiencing your being, right? So in that sense, like some people can have like fulfill their, they must be experiencing a lot of freedom by like whatever, like following or like submitting to God or something. So it can happen both ways because it's a subjective feeling. So in this, if you're looking at the ancient times, of course we have, if you look at the great religion and the philosophies of these great traditions, most of these religions have founded on somewhat similar philosophy, and that have been continued, that's still being continued in one or other form, and it is like still fighting to prove itself as scientific and all. So what I want to ask is, in this current circumstances, in this modern or so-called like postmodern way of thinking, we have emerged like postmodern way of thinking, where we are like giving a lot of importance to a subjective feeling over morality or like morality. What does Nyayashastra has to offer what does Nyayashastra has there to offer to create a God for 21st century, which accepts whatever the diversities or subjectivities without getting conformed to a one particular order or one particular structure? What does Nyayashastra has to offer?
I think you should be a little brief. Can you just...
His question is, how do you interpret the Nyaya kind of God in the contemporary society without going into so many labels and so on? So, yeah, maybe we'll get, let's get more questions, right?
So, thank you for the amazing talk. It looks like, despite observing change everywhere, relative things everywhere, subjectivity everywhere, we desperately cling on to something absolute, objective and general, like Aristotle's or Aquinas's unmoved mover, uncaused cause, to God's representation as omniscient, omnipresent, something absolute. Is it innate to human nature to have this attitude?
So the point is that when we talk about omniscience of science of God, it is we are imposing this idea. The point is this. Actually, when the Nayayikas are trying to put the question, put the point, they say that if a person is creating a pot, he must know what are the things needed for the creation of pot. So in the case some intelligent being is willing to create this world, he must know everything. Without knowing, he cannot create this world. Therefore, the idea of omniscience is coming in Nyaya. It is not our imposition. That is the point. Because I had a paucity of time, could not explain so many things. So, this was there.
Maybe we could take just one or two questions. Yes,
it was very interesting listening to you. But I was thinking about how is this tark about God or not God has changed over a period of time. Because if you refer to Vedas, all these things are perennial of long years. Do you think in 100 years' time, the questions have changed or the understanding has changed? What is that really changed as far as this argument about God is there or not there?
So the point is that the formulations are surely changed. And if you take, I have taken a lot of time explaining the Western development of idea, because there was a clash between these two ideas. And in India, these philosophies are somehow, these darshanas are somehow very much specific regarding these issues. So if you take the concept of freedom of man, so the freedom of man, if you are talking about, this freedom of man is accepted here in the beginning of time, in the NIAS, when NIAS sutras are written at that time, because it was the postulate without making someone free. Suppose you are saying that you have to follow my order, and you are putting a gun on his side, in his head, and you are saying do something. In that case, if someone is performing an act, who is responsible for that? The person who is putting the gun, or the person who is committing the crime? So here it was very much accepted here that man must be free to act. However, if you take the man is free, man cannot be completely free in any situation. And why he is not free? It is not due to God, but due to his own karmas. As he is present here, he is there. So in that case, he is acting, and in that case, he is limited by his own karmas, nothing else. So he is free always. So the freedom is, in Indian context, if you are talking about, the man is always free. But he is limited because of his own karmas, and he is searching for freedom in a larger context so that he could get liberated.
Thank you for the very detailed talk. You covered almost all aspects of God. So,
mic a little away.
Yeah. So my question is, it's a little bit of a thought exercise. So listening to all your arguments, now we are human beings are able to create a lot of things like artificial intelligence. We are making breakthroughs in artificial intelligence. We are able to create complete simulated environments like worlds even in video games. And a lot of even in new both in neuroscience and in artificial intelligence, they are working towards building a consciousness. They are making breakthroughs in studying consciousness and trying to imitate consciousness. So let's say in 100 years, for example, in the 22nd century, we are able to create a consciousness in artificial intelligence in a computer and put it in a simulated environment like in a video game, for example, like in the movie Matrix. So is it right for the artificial intelligence as God? Or what is the concept of God then? How does it evolve then?
So the...
I just want to... there also the artificial intelligence will not be able to perceive us. But according to it, we are omniscient, omnipotent. We are able to change its world. We are able to create one more like it.
Surely.
Yeah.
In that sense, we will be God for this virtual world. There is no problem. And here there is very... And you are taking a long time. There is another point. We are actually those creators. We create in our old world when we are in a dream state. Everything we create ourselves. So we are creating, we are playing in that. No one else is creating that. So in that case, if you are taking that, those stimulators or something which is created, taking our case of artificial intelligence, for them we will be very much like God, but in a limited sense. And in a limited sense, till now we are God, because in God and Atman, there is no qualitative difference. In according to Nyaya, there is no qualitative difference at all. And also in Advaita Vedanta, there is no qualitative difference. Quantitative difference is there, because God knows everything, we know a little. So this is the difference. So this is a quantitative difference. Both are coming in the same group. Atman, this is also Atman, Jivatman, Paramatma. The term is used, Jivatma, Paramatma cha. So we are Jivatma, God is Paramatma. So why he is Paramatma? Because he knows everything.
But should we be distracted from not having artificial intelligence? I mean, you know, what you rather say, I want to just believe in God and believe in his happiness.
Intelligence doesn't become our God. We become the God of the actual.
Yeah.
No, but in today's world, that is what you're condemned for, not accepting artificial
yes. Because of paucity of time, I think we should.
We take that one step back towards the real world. And there is always a question in the scientific community arguing whether we are in a simulation or not. So what if we are in a simulation and there is a God for us? So what do you think about that? If you take that same argument one step backwards for us.
So here only one thing will be happening. That we will be experiencing something due to someone else. Someone else is making us believe in that case. This will be. And in that appearance, we will be controlled by the person. This will be the case. And here he is not becoming God of everything. He will be, in a little sense, God of ourselves.
Because of paucity of time, we will have to limit the number of questions. But thanks for stimulating discussion. If you have more questions, you can mail to us under the CSP website. You can get the mail there, mail address. And now I request Mrs. Niharika, PhD student, to give the vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. I know Mishra, sir, for years now, and I'm still amazed by the knowledge and passion he has for philosophy. So we are very grateful for your presence here today, sir. I also thank my mentor and Professor Sangeeta Menon for this remarkable initiative of Svasthya Rasa Bodhini, in which such stimulating discussions happen and we get together and we learn something new. I thank Shankar sir for chairing this session, the admin staff to make it possible, Team CSP, and the wonderful audience who gathered today, and for your participation and presence. Thank you, everyone.